Oh, hello, hello, everyone. Good morning, good morning, good morning. For those who are in the room, welcome. Welcome to the fourth annual Industry Day Forum, Fed Forum, sponsored by Fed Scoop. Obviously, Brocade has a pretty significant part in this event. Let me introduce myself. My name is Judson Walker. I'm the technical director working for Brocade. My focus is primarily the intelligence community, but I also support other various technical avenues within Brocade Federal. So I've got the privilege today to be the MC for the event, so I get to be the first person you see, and if you're sticking around, the last person you see. So that's going to be awesome. Tweet with us. We want to keep the social media lines lit up all day today. This is our first session or trial where we're actually looking at a technically focused day. And we've got that from a lot of feedback from previous years where a lot of the technologists, the IT professionals in the industry said, hey, look, the business stuff's great, but man, we would love to get more G2 on what's going on technically. What are the solutions out there that we might be able to leverage in the future? And we hope we can talk about multiple things today. Get this. Okay. So I urge you to do the following. Let's connect with each other as we go through the course of the day today. Hopefully there's going to be a lot of questions and comments and interactions with each other as it pertains to what we're talking about, any ideas you may have. Number two, let's collaborate. Let's think differently today, ladies and gentlemen. That's my hope and my wish, that when you listen to the speakers today, both in the main sessions as well as in our technical breakout sessions, or as you go and attend the technical pavilion, you see a lot of these concepts that are on paper here actually being physically put together right on the other side of that door. I hope you walk away with a set of ideas and a new set of tools in your toolkit. This is going to help you kind of modernize your environments and actually think differently and do things differently moving forward. So with that, I'd like to start off with our first speaker. He's our Chief Technologies Officer for Brocade Federal, and he's going to basically kick us off to really talk about this new framework that we refer to as the new IP. The ability for us as technologists to provide solutions that are more flexible, more agile, just because of the necessity of doing just that. Phil has a massive background with over 30 years of experience within the industry, and I think he is one of the leaders as we look at this next evolution of IT modernization. So with that, I'm going to introduce Mr. Phil O'Reilly. Please come up, sir.
Got to make sure I know how the technology works. So I'm Phil O'Reilly. I'm the CTO for Federal. I'm also bound to this microphone, so I guess I'm going to have to stand here and talk to y'all. I'm from Charleston, and I've come on up for this. Thank you. My job is to set this up. I'm not going to be talking about bits and bytes at this point. You'll get a lot of that today. I would encourage you to spend some time out in the technology pavilion, where this stuff comes to life. If you take nothing out of my presentation, understand that the architecture that I'm going to expose to you this morning to remind you as to what the new IP looks like is all available and very real. Every level of it is actually demonstrated in the technology pavilion, and you'll see that. So I wanted to start, however, with a set of questions. Now, this hopefully sets up what's fundamentally different about what we're doing now than what we did in the past, because you're all sitting out there thinking, well, we're technology people. Why is Phil asking me these questions? Okay, why is this important? Well, if there's anything that's changed fundamentally, it's that what we deliver as technologists now is not about the system. It's about the end user's experience. And the person driving this is, in fact, the end user. You don't report anymore to the IT manager in your various agencies. You're responsible to the end user, and you're responsible for the quality and richness of the experience they have. That is not delivered by a set of protocols, by a configuration script, by a provisioning environment. It's delivered by understanding the business objective of the agency and delivering results against that. And in fact, the promise of software-defined networking is the ability to interpret business requirements into a set of relatively natural language rules, apply them against the control environment, which will automate what happens in the network environment below it. So summarizing at a very, very high level what SDN is, that's really what our objective is. And to get from here to there is clearly going to be a journey, the journey that's going to be balanced, unfortunately, on most of your backs. So think about what's happening with networks right now. I think maybe consolidation isn't the right word. I put it up there. Maybe the right word is actually federation, because data center consolidation is clearly a part of what's going on. But what's happening really functionally? What we're doing is we're combining resources where we can efficiently, retaining control over those unique resources that are part of my deliverable in a particular agency. And that federation is really fundamentally around utilization of cloud and cloud services and managed services environments. Don't think for a minute that you're not going to control your own destiny, and frankly, to a great extent, most of the resources used to deliver that destiny, but it will be supplemented by the ability to utilize both internal cloud capabilities that are delivered by the U.S. government, as well as external from people like Amazon Web Services and SoftLayer and Azure and others who are here today. So I know these aren't typical questions, okay? The second question, how do I respond to these? Boy, when I wrote this, I didn't know about what happened last week when I wrote that question. It makes it, I think, even more apropos, though, to the discussion we're having this morning. How do I respond rapidly? What does rapidity require interpreted into a network? Mostly automation and simplification of the network. From a structural perspective, eliminating the fragility of a three-tiered, topologically dependent network and creating much more flexibility and agnosticism towards the way a network is physically configured, and the ability to deliver services on a demand, basically. A very rapidly changing set of services, a rapidly changing set of requirements. That implies that your network ultimately is not going to be bound to the physical assets that currently make it up. I'm not telling you, and I'll tell you later on this morning when I talk to you, I'm not saying you're going to be throwing anything away. You're going to evolve your current network from the standard that you have today to a much more sophisticated standard. But the steps that you're going to take are going to be around primarily automation, and that's really what we're going to be focusing on for the rest of the day today. Simplicity, automation, scalability, and user centricity. Those are the key characteristics of the network that hopefully you'll take from our presentation today as well. So think about these questions and think about how you as an IT professional will be able to deliver these things. So, whoops, a little bit too fast here. So here's the architecture, ladies and gentlemen. You're used to seeing an architecture built on elements, switching, routing, the old, you know, old OSM model, right? It's not the case anymore. These are functional layers of technology, and they have certain characteristics that you'll spend the rest of the day learning about. But some of the overriding considerations are complete openness and fungibility. And by openness, I don't mean a proxy for interoperability. Openness is the ability to replace whole layers of this architecture with anybody's products and have them interoperate in a predictable and scalable way. Interoperability is really the hallmark of the beginning of openness. But ultimately, openness is about the ability to mix and match and the ability to predict using a standardized input what the standardized output is going to look like. So mostly openness is about building predictability into your environment and not variability into the environment. Each of these layers is expressed by a set of technologies. The fundamental architecture begins with physical technology, the hardware layer, the infrastructure that you're currently used to. Nothing that you do is going to go away. In the most advanced manifestation of this technology, we still have switching, routing, firewalls, VPN. We have hardware considerations as they interact with applications, so ADC and these technologies as well. We have all of the technologies that you're used to, but we don't utilize them in the same way that you used to in the past. Each of these layers are distinct so that they can be interchanged, and they're interconnected through a set of very, very standard and predictable APIs. And that is also a characteristic of this new hardware. And we'll spend a lot of time today talking about these interconnections. Oh, okay. I'm being told that if I don't use the microphone, they're not going to be able to pick me up on the video, so I'll use the microphone. The APIs represent the bridge between these layers, and ultimately, it's where you're going to create this automation and efficiency in the network, and we'll be spending a lot of time talking about them. The stack as it's drawn is also probably the order in which you will execute these technologies. You'll begin with the underlay, the physical architecture, primarily packet forwarding, classic layer 2. That remains a fundamental of any network, regardless of where we go with automation and with virtualization. So we'll begin by replacing a rigid, three-tiered, slow, non-hypervisor-optimized environment with a much more flexible fabric underlay. The underlay also encompasses more than just network, and you're going to have to start thinking more broadly. Currently, you all probably interact pretty regularly with the application layer, with the compute guys, okay? Very soon, in fact, for many of you, you're already doing this, you're interacting with your data guys as well. Because now applications can be influenced by the end user and certainly by the data environment. And the data environment is expanding, not just scale, but the types of data that are being utilized by your networks and the way data is being utilized. It's not just archival, it's dynamic. It's analytic. In fact, it's hyper-analytic. So we are doing in-flight analytics on data, applicable particularly to the intelligence community, to DOD, for example, in real-time tactical situations. But even in the civilian area as well, this is the hallmark of this architecture that's driving enterprises towards it. The ability to use data to dynamically and automatically change the way the network is responding to the end user. So that is a fundamental characteristic of the architecture. On top of that, you'll begin to change the services layer, the stateful environments, the old layer 3 to 7 environments that you're used to configuring through physical devices like routers and firewalls. And you'll begin to replace those components with virtualized manifestations of those components, replacing physical routers with virtual routers, probably initially as a simple static replacement of virtual for physical. What do I get from that? A massive capital expenditure reduction, some 90%, by moving from physical to virtual. And I'll talk about that briefly here in a minute. Ultimately, the goal here and the power of NFV and virtualizing network functionality is the ability to deploy those services and to move them. Since they can be deployed in a hypervisor format as well as in bare metal, we have the ability now to associate services with the application as an intimate one-layer, one-hop combination. So the idea of deploying services in a container and then moving them to the appropriate application, dynamically changing them based on the application need, application load, or the user's demands is the ultimate promise of this. As you move into a broader set of virtualized services, you need a new control world because we can't control a network using the analogy I use all the time is currently our networks speak like my 3-year-old does, right? We trap every 3 minutes and we get an SNMP output from the network, okay? That is a rudimentary linguistic environment for communicating the health and state of the network. It needs to change. And fundamental to this, and what's not really stated in many cases, is this change in underlying control capabilities within the network. So OpenFlow is a great example of a much more sophisticated linguistic environment for communicating the health and state of any element in a network, and more importantly, the relationship among elements. So it's not about elemental analysis anymore. It's about system performance analysis. And so the metrics that we'll be talking about for the rest of the day, and you'll see explained in the booth, are about increasing the capability of the network to communicate state, health, condition, capacity. And that's what's going to allow us to execute a new control model, which is the heart of software-defined networking. A software-defined controller layer, which southbound is looking at all of these services, 3 to 7, even the switching services as well, and coordinating them and deploying them automatically against a standardized set of rules, all controlled by a programmatic input into the SDN controller. That is the new task for all of you, is looking at this northbound interface to the SDN controller and understanding not, what I learned isn't important anymore. It's all critically important because you have to understand or know how the network is going to actually execute the rule that you've given it, the business rule that you've given it. But the new skill that you're going to have to learn is to learn about executing the business requirements of your agencies into this environment, which will then automate and drive the infrastructure to deliver those results. That's the third step. The last step is to move from one cloud, a private cloud, or a semi-private cloud environment, a confederation of clouds, to a full multi-cloud environment, public cloud environments. Many of you are already using AWS, AT&T, Amazon Web, SoftLayer, Azure. Many of you already understand the power of being able to utilize those kinds of capabilities to offload, maintain capacity in your core, and to maintain control over those assets, which represent the competitive differentiation for your agency. That integration of multiple clouds is primarily why we will move to orchestration frameworks like OpenStack. These orchestrations allow, again, predictability in the way multi-cloud environments interact with one another, with the ultimate goal of this system, the ultimate goal of the new IP, the ultimate goal of software-defined networking, to deliver the capability of moving workloads anywhere in your network. And by workload, I mean application, network characteristics, and data with absolute impunity. That is the goal of software-defined networking. And if we can deliver that, and we can deliver most of it or parts of it today, then ultimately that gives you the kind of flexibility and the ability to scale to meet the needs of your communities right now. Okay? So here's the architecture kind of blown out. You know, in the past we used to have the ability to say, well, you know, I'm an enterprise-like application. I'm a service provider-like application. I really focus more on a distributed architecture. Now I focus more like ERDC on an internal consumer model as well. In the new IP, it's all the same. It's all the same. There is no artificial boundary, for example, between data center and edge, because ultimately the edge needs to get a lot smarter, and it needs to participate in the automation scheme that I'm deploying in the SDN environment in my data center as well. So we have a new kind of edge, and we have virtualization and capabilities that are being driven out there. I can expose for you on the whiteboard an edgeless network, because if you believe that all the edge is the interaction between end user and application wrapped with a set of policies based on who they are, what they're going to use, how much they're going to use, et cetera, if you believe I can express those services virtually, then why do I need physical devices at the edge? Oh, well, PoE notwithstanding, okay? So I can actually now with this model, with the new IP, build any kind of hybrid between what my data center deliverable is and my edge deliverable is. That's an absolutely new model, okay? Now the crossover between communications and data of any sort is also blurred. So now I have the capability, for example, I was Friday talking to DOD, spent a lot of time talking about tactical cellular, which is a really rapidly evolving capability that's being deployed because of its efficiency and because so many things have already been solved by the carriers. An enterprise utilization of an SP technology, a service provider technology, okay? Those capabilities are part and parcel of this. And so the ability to deliver communications, the so-called Internet of Things, the BYOD problem. We all have 100 names for it, right? All these capabilities mean that you cannot isolate an independent set of functionality into, for example, well, that's my carrier environment, or this is my data center environment, or this is my analytics environment. It's all part and parcel of the same environment. And in fact, the same capabilities should be able to be reconfigured automatically to process any of those required outputs. So here's a general schema for the architecture. Let me see if I can go. Okay. Here's a little bit more detailed look at kind of what the architecture looks like, and you see an awful lot of interfaces here, don't you? Because that's what it's about. It's about primarily creating this service deliverable and then linking it together through a flexible connection. You know, think about your network connections right now. You're bound by the capability of the layer. You're bound by the protocol capability of your routers, for example, what they can do with communicating with other parts of your network. What if I can, by changing an API, change that communications, change the way they interact with one another? I have the ability now to mix and match not just between layers, but among layers in the design. And that's fundamentally what's being delivered here. Obviously, I'm from Brocade, so I put a lot of Brocade stuff on this slide. But I have to tell you point blank, we committed religiously to the concept of open. And openness implies that I can put anybody's products into this system, physical or virtual, and have them interoperate seamlessly. That is truly a fundamental characteristic of this new model, is the ability to put legacy gear, advanced products from any vendor, and many of them are here today. This is not a Brocade event. This is an industry event towards this discussion. They can all be integrated as well. On the right, you see Yang model, you see API, you see NetConf, you see many of these protocols. This is the language that you're going to need to become familiar with to learn, to understand how to drive this environment. You know, in many cases, people think SDN is about the controller and the interface to the devices. It's powerless without the programmatic input. There are also two ways that you can program and interface with this network. Systemically, through this environment, where you're driving these business rule inputs primarily into the SDN controller, potentially into other environments in the network. We have many customers that are scripting OpenStack right now and utilizing a capability without any SDN controller to actually utilize the flexibility of OpenStack in delivering automatically against customer demand. But we also have the ability in this environment to program directly to the elements in this network. The vendors, Brocade included, have clearly embraced the model that hardware is not hardware anymore. Hardware is a blend between purpose-built capabilities that don't make you make a trade-off between scale and performance. So latency and scale should not be a trade-off for you guys. And that requires fundamentally focused hardware elements to deliver that. But balanced against that is the ability to change the behavior of an individual device. So for example, we recommend that you start with a physical architecture change from a rigid three-tiered interconnect to a more fabric-like environment. You've already done it in your data world. We've been delivering it to you for 20 years with storage area networking. It works. It's scalable. It's flexible. It's automated. It's self-healing. It's self-forming, high performance, and very, very low cost in terms of the ability to grow that environment. That's the paradigm that you're going to carry over into the IP world as well. So you deploy our Ethernet fabric products, for example. Those devices, every one of them, will perform and deliver exactly what you're looking for today. But in 3 years, when your layer two environment begins to bridge into other capabilities, when the layer two environment becomes a lot more smarter about executing subroutines and applications, which is what Microsoft is looking at today, you can program that capability directly into the device. Not only does it give you the ability to continue to iterate your network, but it gives you the ability to extend the useful life of the product from 3 to 5 years to probably 7 to 10 years or potentially beyond. So very interesting. A lot of this stuff we're going to be talking about today. So I'm not sure where this computer is. Oh, there we go. Okay, let me go back. So let me briefly cover the layers that we're going to be talking about. Okay, where is the guys, the pickup? Back there, okay. Okay, there's that. Here we go. We talked about that. Okay, so I said you have to start with hardware. The underlay is important. You know, there's a debate about overlay and underlay in the white box discussion. White box has a place if you're Google. And you can put 4,000 people to program. And I tell the story all the time. Remember when I bought my first Apple IIe, right? I wasn't a programming guy, right? And I turned it on. I was so excited, and there's this little letter C blinking. I'm like, what the hell is this? What am I supposed to do with it, right? So that's a white box, sports fans. It has inchoate capability to do, for example, switching. You have to evoke that. You can, but it requires an awful lot of work. More likely, the model, which being driven by Mr. Halverson and others in the Fed space, is COTS. And COTS is about relatively standardized modular functional capabilities within the network, layer 2, layer 3, et cetera, et cetera. So more capability around the middle two, or the first or the second here as well. More around flexibility in deploying capabilities, more around deploying automated, self-healing, self-forming capabilities. So, for example, an Ethernet fabric, by the nature of the design, automatically load balances. There's no need for an independent device to do that. By the nature of the protocol, by the nature of the configuration, those of you that have a SAN experience know exactly what I'm talking about as well. It creates a kind of persistence that's unique to this design. And that's the capability that you're going to need. Because as the SDN controller gets smarter and smarter, it unfortunately creates an assumption about the continuous performance of the underlay. So you have to start by thinking about underlay reformation. And we're going to be spending a lot of time talking about today. I would encourage you to go to Mike Bouchon's presentation on physical infrastructure. I think you'll find that very, very interesting. So we start there. Next, we go to network functions virtualization, the deployment of VNFs, virtualized network functions. And by the way, they are different things. NFV is the framework, which includes the control elements, not just the services, which have been manifested now virtually versus physically. Okay? This initiative, interestingly enough, was begun by the service providers, who said to vendors like Brocade, we cannot continue to scale our capital environment to meet our customers' needs. Because I don't know about you guys, but I use about 40 times more capacity on my smartphone than I did 4 years ago, and I pay about $13 a month less. Okay? That's the dilemma that the service providers have. I would ask people in this room to say, do you have that dilemma in the federal government as well? More deliverables, less money. Okay? You have to break that capital model, and this is a way to do it. Not just CapEx, because as I indicated to you, I can prove to you that replacing a physical device with a virtual device represents roughly a 90% reduction in capital expenditure. How is this possible? It's not Brocade that's making this possible. It's Intel. It's the chip manufacturers who've built so much capability into x86 processors that you can now get the kind of performance you need cooperatively in a core, in a server, that you needed independent processing capability for in the past. So I can use capabilities in the x86 world to deliver not just application performance, but also services performance. And that's the key to VNFs, is the ability to deploy them in a compute environment which has the raw capacity to deliver. I can give you a router today which will look, feel, perform indistinguishably from anything you have in your network. And if I told you it was virtual, you wouldn't believe me. I have it on my laptop if anybody wants to see it. Okay? So we start by deploying, as I said, probably a replacement of physical for virtual, virtualizing the network appliance, a static conversation. Many cases, many of our customers now, and this runs into the literally hundreds of customers at this point, do that as a bare metal deployment of the virtual service capability as well. But the next step is hypervisor deployment of these capabilities. And when you do that, the power of a VNF is the ability now to make the service mobile and to deploy the service anywhere in the network where it's necessary. If you followed what I said and you believe that we've created now this huge flat mesh layer 2 interconnect that supports all of the operations in your network with a layer 2 or an Ethernet fabric, then you now have the ability to deploy applications and services in a single layer, not only increasing capacity and performance, but also inherently increasing security in the network. Because I've isolated now transactions into a single layer, and I can now control them and visualize them across fewer and fewer connections in the network. And that's the goal of first changing your physical infrastructure and then deploying VNFs on top of it. The next step, as I indicated, is, got to point it in the right direction. Okay? Well, let me make this point. If I gave you a virtual router and it didn't do everything that your current router does, it doesn't matter that it's virtual, does it? You're not going to use it. You're not going to care about that. So table stakes is the virtual services functionality is identical in terms of protocol support, capabilities, density, communications, capacity, as any physical device that you have. I put my hand up here as a Navy officer and a gentleman and promise you that the virtual functions that are capable of being delivered today, not just by Brocade, but by many others, are meet this standard. And you will not have any issues with regard to integrating them. You're not going to have to make any compromises. Whoops. Wow. Crazy. Okay. So we've talked about then the control layers above it. OpenStack, I'm getting the hook here, ladies and gentlemen. So I'm going to speed it up here a little bit. I talked about SDN control. I talked about the orchestration control. Let me briefly cover some of the use cases that are currently deployed, either in POC or in production in many cases. So first, wow, this is just crazy the way it jumps around. Okay, distributed enterprise, really a common application for SDN. The ability to create multi-tenant environments really flexibly using virtual routing. This is a current technology that's being deployed in enterprise and would be, particularly for civilian agencies, of huge value. That's available to you today. The ability to create a flexible edge. That's what the carriers are doing with this technology as well. Think about what that means in terms of the ability to put group task orientation to do, for example, associating commander's intent with the consumer of that output and allowing the commander to control that. Those are all capabilities that are being delivered today. Certainly, DoD is one of the fastest and hottest growing areas for us as well. The tactical network needs to be much more edge-focused. In my general presentation, you'll hear me talk a lot about the change in the nature of the network in utilized as a tactical resource for the Department of Defense. And fundamentally, utilizing these capabilities, there's about a dozen insertion points that we're currently looking at. WIN-T, many of you on the DoD side are familiar with. This is the ability to replace a stack of virtual devices, CPE and a Humvee, with a single or a pair of servers which have the data center deployed on it virtually. And that's a capability that's available today. We now have a sophisticated screen capability in which we can actually now visualize and interpret the data that I talked about. We have now the translator that can accept this communication input, this sophisticated communication input from the network, and interpret it. It's a VistaPoint is the Brocade product, but there are many, many others. And we'll be talking about that today, and you'll see several as well. And ultimately, the ability to use the network to get smarter about the network, about the data that the network is consuming, and about the way applications are being utilized and deployed. Machines are better at learning than we are, guys. I'm not talking Skynet here. I'm talking the ability to utilize our own networks to increase this automation and this pace of iteration in the design of the network. And that capability is also being demonstrated today. So hopefully I whet your appetites a little bit. I think the rest of the speakers today and the rest of the breakout sessions are going to put flesh on these bones. But I appreciate your focus and your ability to stay with me this morning. First thing, I hope you all had coffee. I wish you great luck today. And I want to thank you on behalf of Brocade and all of our vendors for coming today and sharing with us. I think this is going to be a great opportunity for all of us to learn and to move. So thank you.
Thank you, Phil. Thank you for that that presentation. We are now about to transition into kind of our individual breakout sessions for this particular block of instruction. And really the objective here is to identify four specific areas of interest that we believe will be key to the evolution of the new IP. So let me just kind of throw them out there and kind of where they are. There's going to be a main session located here, in here, and it's going to be focused on the Ethernet fabric and what that is. And that particular block of instruction will be presented by Mr. Greg Castellucci. He's a senior technical architect with Brocade, and he'll talk a little bit about that technology and why we believe as a true underlay it has true value. Then, going through the double doors to my right, there will be three additional sessions that you can actually join. One session is actually going to be presented by Mr. Clive D'Souza. Mr. D'Souza works for Intel, and he's going to talk a little bit about network functions virtualization and the benefits of the Intel chipset and really taking that and really showing high performance, high reliability, high durability from a virtual routing, switching, load balancing, virtual services standpoint. So he'll be talking to you a little bit about that. There is the second workshop, again, located to my right, will be focused on Open Daylight. The presenter will be Mr. Tom Nadeau. Tom Nadeau is a chief architect out of the CIO's office with Brocade. But his primary function really is a key contributor to the Open Daylight Foundation. So he's one of the key decision makers as far as what gets ported into that open forum and how the application or the open source code today is being manipulated. He also does a lot of open source projects as well. So I urge you, if you have any time to chit chat with Mr. Nadeau, either during the session or shortly afterwards, I would love for you to take advantage of that. So that's session number two. Session number three will be presented by Mr. Doug Brown. Doug Brown is a senior engineer with Brocade, and he's going to focus today or this morning on the OpenStack technology, the deal about providing true end-to-end orchestration, focused on both compute, network, and storage, and how you can use a set of tools such as OpenStack to be a true collaboration tool for you based on defined policies to basically spin up and tear down very specific workloads. So with that, please just stand up. Any of those four individual breakouts are of interest to you. Again, three will be through the doors to my right. Mr. Castellucci will be presenting here in the main area. And again, the duration for these breakout will be 30 minutes. So please go to what interests you the most. Thank you.